Hello, Pavel, and welcome to our today's stream on the reversed Sicilian defense.
So hello, Grigor. Hello, everyone. I hope it will be quite useful. I wanted to share my experience from both colors, from point of view on black and white, in this very interesting setups.
Yeah, at the beginning, I would just want to make some short introduction. This discussion is an introduction to our camp concerning the reversed Sicilian. The camp will be held this weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And by looking at the games of Pavel Eljanov, you will get a better feeling about the different pawn structure, theoretical ideas, theoretical trends, if you want. And those of you who will participate in the camp will get an access to the PGM file related to the analysis of Pavel Eljanov. So, Pavel, first of all, let me ask you a general question. What is your general opinion about the reversed Sicilian? What do you think is the current state of this opening?
Yes, so in general, the current state of every opening that more or less everywhere black is doing fine, although it depends on your style and depends on your certain approach. If you want to play some playable position, some less forced lines, I mean with white mainly, then maybe it makes sense to have c4 in your aperture, because yeah, and especially if you play Sicilian with black, of course, because it's not a big surprise that such a sharp players like Daniil Dubov, Jan Nepomniachtchi, who are a big apologists of Sicilian defense, they're also playing c4 on move one. So I probably heard in some interview or some comments from Daniil Dubov that this is his favorite opening, actually c4, and quite frequently he plays c4. On move one, and of course also c5 with black after e4.
Concerning black's point of view, I think that e5 is a very interesting way of meeting c4, because it actually is some kind of a radical solution, I think, because if you play not e5 but let's say knight f6 or c5 or something else, white has a very, very big choice, and you can play a different kind of positions.
Yeah, sure. In general, this opening is quite wide from point of view of different ideas, different pawn structures. And in general, I wanted to say also that, okay, maybe it's not, as I said, not so forced in many lines, and maybe sometimes you have to be ready just play some unclear playable position. But in general, this is quite interesting approach in modern chess, because in general it's quite boring sometimes to learn some endless forced lines in some classical openings like Grünfeld on Queen-Xindian, just to have a chance on move 25 to get some slight advantage.
Of course.
It's quite boring.
Of course.
And in general, this is quite different approach. You are learning not only opening in English from point of view of English opening, but also different ideas which is connected to Sicilian. And in general, if you know better this kind of positions, it's already quite certain advantage against your opponents, because in general it could be more important to know better your position than to have some objective slight advantage out of the opening.
Of course. So we can already start examining your games. And actually the first game is quite a positional game, which can actually provide black with a decent practical weapon against c4, e5, knight c3. So this is your game against Santos Watashe, if I'm not wrong. And we can start. So you play with black, c4, mm-hmm. e5, knight c3. You play immediately bishop b4.
Yeah, don't be confused. I mean, I'm talking to attendees, to visitors, because the header is different, but actually it's all my games here.
Yes, of course.
Yeah, because there is a header, Eljanov Grishuk, but yeah, this is bishop before. This is what I played with black quite recently. Actually, it was my last tournament at the moment, and I played against like a member of Team World against Team Spain in the end of 2020. So I played first time in my life, I believe, bishop before second. So in general, yeah, Santos, there is two players, two young players in Spain. Santos, I played against Jaime Santos. And another one is Miguel. So Jaime Santos is more creative player, I would say, but they are both strong, actually. They are both strong player around 2600 in general, maybe even stronger. And actually, yeah, the point is, it was kind of surprise.
Yeah.
He played c4 because normally he plays something else, but as I said, he is quite creative and probably he wanted to surprise me. And actually, I decided to surprise him in return, to play ahead of him. And the reason I played, because I analyzed it just a little bit at some time before the tournament, this line.
So he went knight d5 here?
Yes, so I decided this is the proper moment to play knight d5 and a5. So yeah. Here black has a very decent choice. a5 wasn't the main move for many years, because normally black is choosing something like bishop c5 or bishop e7. Yeah, two main options were considered, bishop c5 and bishop c7. A5, it's quite modern approach, and maybe Anand played most of the time from the top players. I wanted to try it, just to try to have some playable position.
Yes,
White normally play a3 in this moment, or maybe after knight f3, so there is some choice.
Yeah, let's just explain the main idea of the move a5. I guess that black is gaining space on the queen side. At the same time, he secures the c5 square for the bishop. And of course, at some point, when we play c6 and white recaptures the bishop, we are just ready to take with the pawn, right?
Yeah, sure. So, yeah, I'm securing also a7 square. Actually, I can play bishop f7 at some point, not on bishop c5.
This is the old bishop theory. E7. Yeah, bishop e7.
I mean, after a5, a3 also, it's possible.
Yeah.
But also my idea was to put bishop on c5, which is, in my opinion, the most sound option.
So a3, you played bishop c5 here.
Yeah.
And he went for knight f3.
Yeah, knight f3. This is the main way to play with white and d6.
d6. Actually, instead of knight f3, I wanted just to ask you what you think about this move b4. Does it work just to play for quick development? A takes b4, then bishop b2?
Yeah, I had this like some option. It was just brief notes, actually. Position after takes, which is a
takes bishop,
which is a right. So I'm not sure.
B2,
I'm not
I mean.
Sure what's going on here. Sorry.
So you take on b4, bishop b2.
Yeah. I'm not sure what's going on here, but looks interesting. But in general, black has no weaknesses, and black has a decent development. Should be at least acceptable for black in general.
Yeah. So, as far as I remember, the line goes like this: take, take, take. Bishop takes c5,
yeah.
Knight f6, e3. This short castle went. It looks acceptable for black, right?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, then we proceed with the game. Knight f3 was played. So.
Yeah, so here I believe someone played e4 here. I don't remember. Maybe it was some Gorodetsky-Moisenko game, if I'm not mistaken.
You mean e4?
No, I mean d6.
Just a second.
Besides d6, there is maybe e4. And knight g5. This idea is quite interesting, just to check it.
Just after taking to play d4, right? Yeah.
Yeah, if I'm not mistaken. If I'm not mistaken, here e4, it's not the proper choice. Or maybe immediately d4. Actually, I don't remember. But if e4, it's not.
Okay.
It's not a good move for sure, as far as I
remember. I see. Okay. So the game continued d6, and
so d6.
And
yeah.
And here
actually white has a decent choice. Besides e3, there is also d4 option. So I'm not sure who played d4. Maybe not so many games white chose d4, but in general, it makes sense to play this structure. Also.
I just wanted to discuss this structure with you a little bit. After e takes d4, knight takes d4. Okay, it's obvious that due to the c4 pawn, which gives a good central control and a space advantage, white is structurally better. Therefore, black should compensate these structural problems by playing very dynamically.
Yeah, sure. So, but in general, it's not that clear whether knight on d5 is properly placed, because white is underdeveloped. White is not yet developed his king side, which is quite important. So, next move knight e7. Black is starting to undermine white position. And it's not that clear. Yes, strategically, you are absolutely right that white is should be at least a bit better, but it depends on dynamic here also.
So
because dynamically, white is still a bit vulnerable here. So it's not that clear, too early to make any conclusion here.
So here, as far as I have checked, the main line goes bishop g5. f6,
mm-hmm.
Bishop f4, and here short castle, e3, knight c6.
Yeah.
At some point, there will be a structural transformation, which is very typical for the English opening. Knight takes d5, and then the c4 pawn will land to d5 square. What do you think about this structural transformation, for example?
In general, black has a backward pawn on c7, and in general it gives white certain advantage, but also black is well developed here. Actually, black is a bit ahead here just for the moment, and also bishop on f4 is a bit misplaced, because In general, I can attack bishop with knight g6 and maybe f5. This is one of the ideas. So in general, my conclusion was that maybe it just very slightly better, but nothing special. Nothing special for white. In general, position is quite playable and could be even double-edged. So yeah, but in general, it's quite important to understand all this kind of structures and the difference in general.
Okay, thank you. So we proceed with the game. The game was e3.
Yeah.
And now knight d7, quite a flexible move.
Yeah, yeah. So in general, yeah, probably c6 also possible. I'm not sure whether it differ. I mean, most likely it will transpose. I mean, just not really necessary to put a lot of attention to this move orders, because anyway d4.
Yes, d4 will come.
This is what white will play.
So bishop a7.
Bishop a7, yeah, but in general, yes, maybe here it makes some sense, because, yeah, as far as I remember now, there is knight c3, there is some game Pankratov-Adyaban, yeah, and Pankratov played just immediately, knight c3, but I'm not sure, maybe c6 makes sense to play here immediately, so knight gf6, he played very creative, g4,
yes.
So. Yeah, g4. Actually, it makes a lot of sense in this kind of structures. I mean, it's not like first time we see this idea. Yes.
Yes. So everyone who is familiar with the games of Alexei Shimov will remember it.
Yeah. So also this move quite popular in Shahriyar Mamedyarov games.
Of course. Yes.
He also trying to play all the time g4 if it's possible. I mean, he likes it.
So let's return to bishop e2. You played c6, knight c3, and okay, the critical position arises here, and maybe we can stop for a while and evaluate this position, because this is quite similar to the Indian defense, where we have the bishop on e7 and white has his pawn on e4, but here with a pawn on e3 and a bishop on a7, I think that this version is quite favorable for black, because you have some attacking ideas based on bishop b8, e4, d5, rook e8, and you start playing on the king side. Is that correct?
Sure. So actually, I learned all this kind of ideas from Matthias Bluebaum games, because he played at least few times already this position, and you see in annotations that he won some chess.com game, and also he played, I don't remember exactly against whom, but I like it the way he played this, and in general it's very sound. Yes, I'm about to expand my central pawns, and also I have a lot of chances to attack. Actually, this is exactly what I did in the game, although it was quite double-edged.
Let's take a look at the game. So queen c2 was played.
Yeah. So it's absolutely possible. I mean, makes sense. Also not necessary, because yeah, b3 or b4 immediately also makes sense. So rook e8,
b4. I suggest that we go a bit faster, because we want to look at more games today, just to point out the critical moments and the critical ideas,
sure.
If you want. So
yeah. So
bishop b8 was played in the game.
Yeah, so I invented the same idea as Bluebaum in
B5.
Some of his games. You saw b5.
B4.
He played e4, so d5 immediately was possible, but this is most human option. I decided to expand my central pawns.
Knight d2, d5, and here he started playing on the queen side by means of a4.
Yeah, till this point we played absolutely most logical moves we did, I suppose. And yeah, first position where I had some choice here, knight b6 was possible. Actually, I considering little bit, I was considering it, but I decided to play the more routine move, which is also okay. So knight b6 looks a bit strange from first point of view, because I'm losing two tempos after c5, but to close the queen side in this manner also quite good from strategical point of view for black. And here I have a lot of play on the king side, and it's not so easy at all for white to break through on the different side of board. So knight b6 was interesting, and it makes sense to remember this idea, actually.
Quite an instructive option. Okay, so knight f8, bishop a3 was played, and here you decided to provoke g3 by playing queen c7.
Yeah, also I believe quite human option, but yeah, knight g4 was good, actually, because I'm forcing some weaknesses, because h3 it's hardly possible. Then knight h2 also, easiest, okay. Maybe, so it's not possible, and g3 immediately also possible, because not possible, I believe, because knight takes h2, and only option is to take
check.
Yeah.
This is mate, right?
Yeah, quite typical way how to mate in this case.
Just to demonstrate, okay.
So it was actually the way to provoke exchange of quite important bishop, which is important from point of view of defense, first of all, because then he has to play g3, because also queen h4 on the agenda, and some point bishop takes h2 also in this kind of position is quite typical. So g3 it's necessary. Although it's not that easy anyway, because still it's very far, of course, to open the king side in a proper way, and still it's not that clear. But I believe it's already, I can say already that my position has to be preferred in general from my point of view.
Yes. Okay.
Because according to engine, evaluation is about equal still.
So we proceed with the game. You played queen c7, g3, queen d7.
Yeah.
So you're heading for the h3 square, I guess.
Yeah, it was quite tempting, but still, I believe I was a bit too optimistic here, because position is absolutely unclear.
So he played b takes c6, he took, and then rook fc1, which according to the computer is inaccuracy, right?
Yeah, something like that. Although not a big inaccuracy. Because bishop g5, it's a bit unhuman. This is what...
bishop b5, you mean, yeah.
This is what I proposed. That the way to play here, it's a bit unhuman, because the knight takes e4.
Wow.
It's not that clear why from first sight. But the reason is to defend the second rank, first of all, because knight g4... it's not mate anymore, because there is f3.
So the line goes rook takes e4, I guess. Knight e4, knight g4, f3. And this was the idea.
But it looks unhuman here, in my opinion.
Nowadays, if you play like this, you are going to be disqualified.
Yeah, absolutely. If you are not some top player, yes.
Okay, so rook fc1.
Yes, rook fc1, which is quite a human option, normal move, and still
queen h3, okay, quite a natural
quite natural, and bishop f1, and here also I played quite natural move, but in general I won thanks to this mistake. Quite paradoxical, yes.
Yes.
But sometimes it happens, yes. Also, I was optimistic here, as I said, I was still optimistic. And maybe my optimism is also
paid off, yeah.
Yeah, paid off, yeah. So, yeah, in general, knight b5, he played, yes, a bit carelessly. He made this move because after knight g4, I'm destroying his king side. So instead, bishop b5 was much more to the point because he is not attacking only, but he is also defending because now he has knight f1.
F1 square is available for the knight.
Yes, quite typical. You are
bishop d7.
You are. And bishop f8. So by playing very simple chess, he had the chance to intercept an initiative. Yeah.
Yes, bishop b5, knight b5, rook f8, and now maybe white is already better.
Yes, clearly better. So quite simple chess, and so I was lucky, of course, at least a bit here, because instead of defending this quite unpleasant position already,
he played knight b5 actually.
I just started to making attack already at this point instead of
knight g4
of getting some inferior position.
Knight
yeah.
g4 h3 and here you just sacrifice the knight.
Yeah, this is. And this is actually the best way according to engines. So I have a big advantage already, despite I am pieced down here.
So
but
here I think that you already have a decisive advantage, and the attack is very strong. Maybe we can proceed with the next game because. I think that we managed to cover the most important ideas in this game.
Yeah, sure. I believe we have a lot of interesting material.
So now we proceed with the with your game against Alexander Grishchuk, a game that you have lost in 2017, but actually this game was very important for the theory of the English opening.
Sure. I believe it's actually the most important game of decade. I mean, it's not an over-evaluation, I believe, because he actually found the whole new concept on the highest level.
So here you are playing with white and Grishchuk is playing with black. Let's take a look at the first game, at the first moves. Okay, here the move order is not so important actually, because after e5 we enter reversed Sicilian again. Knight f3, knight c6, g3, d5. C takes d5, knight takes d5, bishop g2, and here comes the big move, bishop c5.
Yeah, this is actually it was absolutely new at the moment, so it was only 4 years ago, even less than 4 years ago, but it was a absolutely new concept here on the highest level, because nobody played from top grandmaster bishop c5 before, and after it was it became just topical way to play, the same as knight b6. I mean, this is already the main move here, second main option, or maybe even first nowadays, together with knight b6.
Yes, so how can you explain the main concept behind the move bishop c5?
Yeah, I mean, very concept is very quite clear, is to keep knight on b5 as much as possible, and it's absolutely logical to try to keep it on d5 because no reason to go to b6 without big danger, yes.
Yes.
And just continue to develop here. So in general. In general, it was
knight b6 was the main move at this time, right?
It was yes, it was main moves at least for one century.
Yeah, I because at some point the d5 knight is hanging. Also, black wants to take control of the d4 square with the queen, to prevent any d4 possible ideas.
Sure. So. It was a fantastic concept. So actually, it was a quite well-known pattern that it's very it's very dangerous to play this because of knight e5 and in different kind of positions, but also with reversed colors. But knight e5 it is a key idea in this kind of situation when you have a knight on d5 which is hanging. So. Yeah, first of all, it was, of course, quite principled to try knight e5, but actually still no one played it. I mean, there is only one game, Ding Liren Rajabov, in the highest level, and no one tried.
Let's take a look a bit at knight e5, because this move shows the tactical justification of bishop c5.
Yeah, sure.
So knight takes c3.
Yeah, knight takes e3, and in case b takes, it just equal position, because black has a very good pawn structure, and it's not really dangerous in the end game to lose the castle, and in general c6, yes, absolutely, c6 is the next move, and.
Okay.
Black has nothing to worry
so
about.
So this game, Ding Liren against Rajabov, they played bishop takes c6, right?
Yeah, but still black has a quite good compensation.
Queen d5, so we have a pair of bishops, some attacking chances, we can play on the white squares, quite a decent position, which was proved in the game, I think.
After
knight f3, bishop
so
h3.
Yes, so in general, my conclusion was it's not really white has no much prospects here, so no make no sense to play it with white. I mean, over the board, this is what I thought, and in general, my drawback was in general during the game that. I was a bit too optimistic. In general, this is my approach and motivation in general, because it's clear that if Grishuk playing something like bishop c5, so he has something in mind. So if there is any flaws in this concept, it could be really hard to prove over the board anyway. So it was better, it was more practical. It would be more practical the decision to play here more solid and maybe to make a draw at some point. So I played
short castle.
A bit too much ambitious.
So the game went castle, he castled, and here you played d3.
Yeah, d3, which is normal, absolutely normal way to play, and bishop b6 in general. In general, there is three options here. Besides bishop b6, there is also h6 and rook e8. All these options makes a lot of sense in general. And it's quite unclear what to suggest for black. In general, I remember, I played by myself rook e8, some blitz games.
Yes.
With some decent results, and also h6. This is the latest discovery, as far as I remember, because it was It was invented by Giri, I remember, and he played already at least three times here, h6, which is, of course, mark of quality. If Giri played it so many times, so h6 may be the most fashionable options to conclude.
Maybe we can just explain a bit this arising pawn structure. It's clear that White will try to put pressure on the queen side by using the c-file, the c5 square, also the pressure along the long diagonal. Later on, he can play bishop d2, rook c1, knight a4, knight c5. On the other hand, black is trying to create a central activity and play on the king side, right?
Sure. So, yeah, in general, black has a lot of space and strategically, black is doing fine, but white is trying to undermine black's position by playing on the queen side, especially, and trying to use vulnerability of knight on d5. But it's not an easy task at all.
So,
here,
he played bishop b6, and you played knight a4, which is quite logical.
Yes, quite logical from the third side, but in many situations, black is ready to swap this bishop against knight. I mean, we can recollect probably another line with fifth move e3 and bishop b4. Actually, I had another game against Lasnichka.
Okay.
So black is quite often giving up this bishop. So it's actually also quite typical idea to give up this bishop at some point, because black is very solid in the center.
And what is the most critical try for white in this position? What do you think?
Yeah, in this position, there is some game stake on d5 and b4. Maybe it was invented by Boris Gelfand, as far as I remember.
I think Dubov has played in this way, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah, probably Dubov also. Probably
yeah, this
Dubov
is the game
also.
Dubov-Karyakin from Tbilisi, 2017.
Yeah, actually, as far as I remember, Karyakin...
He went for e4 in this position.
Karyakin had a lot of troubles here, and he lost to Nakamura, as far as I remember also. And here actually white has some pressure at least, because a5, as far as I remember, a5, this is the key option. Because e4, the way Karyakin played, I don't like it, because this is also possible, but white has just a free initiative after e4, as far as I remember. And a5 makes more
sense.
B takes
a5, and here we can recapture with the knight, with the queen.
With the knight, this is what I prefer maybe for black. Because you see that queen c2, knight b3, this is the idea. Because knight b3 is a bit annoying. It's not... Not like big tactical. It's not like tactical. Some big tactical threat, but mainly it's more strategical threat. And then bishop b2 f6. This is the idea to limit.
To stabilize the position.
To limit bishop activity, dark squared bishop, and no. Basically, black is solid here. In general, it's quite playable, although, as I said, instead bishop b6, h6 or rook
yes.
e8
okay.
could be.
So let's proceed with the game. It was knight a4 and here rook e8.
Yeah, rook e8. And again, as I said already, I tried to play ambitiously, although something like b3 was maybe more solid, just to keep my pieces together. And so on. So I decided to provoke something by
bishop
playing
g5,
bishop
queen
g5.
d6.
Yeah, and knight d2. Yeah, it looks quite ambitious, but in general, it was the wrong moment to be ambitious because, yes, the game I lost and without a big fight in general because.
Queen g6 okay, was played, yeah.
Yes, still I didn't make any mistakes, but knight e4 maybe it was a bit too much already because bishop takes d5 was just a normal way to play with approximately equal position.
Yes. Okay, so it was knight e4, bishop g4, very strong move.
Yeah, because black has very pleasant position, I mean, very good control over the center, and it's not really important that I have two bishops, maybe, but actually I didn't even capture this bishop, actually, on b6.
Yes.
I was not I didn't get a proper moment to capture it, and... Yeah, after bishop g4, my position started to degrading with every
h3,
move.
H3, bishop e6, bishop d2, and here rook ad8. It's clear that already black is dominating the board. He controls all the important squares.
Yeah, it's. I wanted to add also that it's very important to put the rook in the proper moment, because I was about to play knight c5.
Okay.
Okay, either knight to c5, and it was important to put the rook first on d8 and then bishop c8. This is quite the most logical way how to defend b7 square. In general, not only reversed Sicilian, but of course in normal Sicilian. Yes.
Yeah, I believe that in such a position, Dorfman will be happy about this outpost.
Yeah, sure, because I know this material from Dorfman. He likes very much outpost, this kind of outpost.
He says that,
and actually his evaluation it could be a bit too harsh, because he would evaluate it like already winning for black, but in general, from practical point of view for human, this evaluation makes sense because it's quite unpleasant to play.
Of course. Okay, king h2. Now Grishuk started preparing f5.
Yeah,
just the typical plan in such structures: a3, f5, knight c5, bishop c8. So you played.
Yeah, in general, yes. My position is degrading, and e4. This is a logical follow-up, and yeah, I think e3. Okay, d takes, it's a bit unhuman also, but I think the last chance was...
D takes e4.
After, yeah, the last chance, after e3, d takes probably better, but it's unhuman, but after takes on c5 takes b6, knight b3, bishop a6, yeah, this is what I did, knight c1, this is actually horrible way of play from point of view of human. It would be better, of course, to suck than exchange by playing d4.
Ah, d4, okay, just a sec.
Yeah, d4, because at least I have some strategical
you
trumps.
Take with...
So it's absolutely not enough. I mean, my compensation is absolutely...
Yeah, but at least some play on the c-file.
At least some play, yeah. Knight e7, c6, he has, of course, much better position, but still I have at least some way of to get some counterplay, I mean, some chance at least.
And this knight keeps everything under control.
Yeah, black is better.
So I believe that after bishop a6, the game is not so so relevant or
not so interesting.
Yeah, so yeah.
So it was absolutely one-sided game because, yeah, it was a whole new concept and very sound one, and also because I was too ambitious. So in general, to conclude, it's quite risky to be over ambitious, actually.
Yes, and what do you...
Because,
okay.
Because black has a very good strategical, the number of strategical trumps, a very good center, a lot of space, and so on. In general, it's not, white has to be, white has to play quite resolutely in many kinds of, in different kinds of the structure.
Yes, so you believe in this concept with bishop c5, and you predict a bright future for this line.
Yeah, well, it's future and the present, yeah. Already. Present is already bright. So in general, I would prefer to play bishop c5 by myself, probably, because it makes a lot of sense. Why not to keep this knight on b6, because it's a bit illogical.
Okay.
If you can keep on d5, why you should avoid it? So in general, it makes a lot of sense to play with black bishop c5.
So now, if you want, we can proceed with one game featuring doubled pawns on the c file. This is your game against Khmelnike, and actually this is the lecture that I will be giving during the English camp, so it will be very interesting for me to be aware of your insights about this structure.
Yeah,
so
sure,
c4,
sure.
Knight f6, just a second, e5, now bishop b4 was played.
Yeah, this is the way I normally I was playing, like maybe for 10 years, for last 10 years, something like that. Actually, I'm not only a five player, but actually, yeah, bishop b4, and sometimes I played d5 also, but normally bishop b4 my first choice here.
Yes, okay, so bishop g2.
Yeah, the way we played till rook e8, this is absolutely main line for both sides. And rook e8 is a bit rare. It's a bit rare because h6 is clearly the main option here. And rook e8, I'm trying to save the tempo by postponing h6.
Okay.
And the idea is that the most routine move, the way he played exactly, probably quite harmless here.
Yes, okay, so he played bishop g5. Just to present the basic ideas, what would you do in case of a normal move like rook b1, which was already played?
Yeah, yeah, rook b1, this is what I played by myself also with Dwight against Yuri Krivoruchka, my friend and my compatriot, and yeah, this is actually quite rare. Yeah, you see there is only one some actually correspondent game which is played after my game against Krivoruchka actually, and idea is quite logical to play some useful move. And I'm just anticipating
bishop takes c3.
Bishop takes c3, yes. I'm anticipating this, and then I'm having rook on a proper square already on b1. And sometimes knight e1 or knight d2 also could be an idea after rook b1. So, and in future, yeah, I'm just putting my rook in the proper square on b1 to put some pressure along b file.
Yeah.
And also another idea to get rid of bishop from b4, and then from b4, and after it also I have b4 idea also.
Yes.
If black is avoiding exchange on c3, then b4 another idea. So in general, in most of the cases it's quite useful.
And also in this structure, if Black maybe should try to play e4, because otherwise there is also this idea for white: e4, then knight e1, knight c2, knight e3, and then just start pushing the pawns on the king side.
Yeah, sure. So e4, actually it's...
This is the typical reaction for black.
It's quite typical, because after e4 with white, if white will play e4, it could be quite unpleasant strategically already. And also maybe in this case my rook is a bit misplaced on e8. Actually, no, I mean, it's maybe too harsh to say it's misplaced, but in general, black can try to get some counterplay after e4 by playing f5. So
yes,
you have to put your knight somewhere and then to try to advance
but
f5.
Here...
And this position is quite double-edged. I mean, it's clear that white has two bishops, and in general it's more pleasant to play with white, although maybe nothing special as usual. But still, white has a decent version.
So maybe we can just show them that this typical idea, when the knight lands on e5, just to play f4 to get rid of black's e4 pawn. And this structure is not without a venom for black.
Yeah. So in general, you recollected Dorfman. Dorfman also could be happy to keep pair of knights for white.
Yes.
Because he likes, according to his theory, he likes to keep the pair of knights. If you have also two bishops, then it makes a lot of sense to keep pair of knights.
And what is the logic behind his concept?
The logic is you have just more resources if you have an extra knight, so you have a more combination with knight and with two bishops in general.
The knight will provoke weaknesses that will be used by the bishop pair.
Yeah, something like
yeah,
that.
Okay.
Something like that.
Okay.
Yeah, but here I'm not sure, because knight on e5 is annoying, because he is pressing d3. Yeah, so this is the way. Yeah, so in general, it's not that easy to get some advantage with white after rook e8, because white has a lot of different options and something like knight d5 and so on, but not that
okay,
easy.
Okay, so bishop g5 was played.
So bishop g5, yes, as I said, the most routine move is actually quite harmless here, because first I take on c3, because otherwise he is about to take and knight d5, or knight d5 immediately.
Yes, let me just point out the idea, knight d5. Or...
Yeah, because if h6, he just take and knight d5, and then he will push my bishop somewhere.
Yes, and now a3, bishop c5.
a3, b4, and my bishop my bishop in troubles, maybe even a4 here.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. But in general, looks troublesome here for black.
So bishop takes c3, b takes c3.
Yeah, here I'm just... and h6, very logical.
So...
Yeah, I played some titled Tuesday game, probably against Donchenko, young grandmaster from Germany. And in general, if you are trying to keep this bishop, it's also a bit risky from strategical point of view. Here, he played bishop e3, he lost some time also. But let's say he play bishop
but,
c1.
Khmelnikov played bishop takes f6, I believe, yeah.
Yeah.
Donchenko played bishop e3.
Yeah. So bishop e3, knight g4 and f5 just in time to limit e4 options for white.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, so...
So...
So after f5, black is fine, I believe. Sometimes, if you are not be able to push e4, then it makes no much sense to keep the bishop in general.
Okay, so...
Because I don't see a big future here of dark squared bishop.
Yes. White should try to keep this bishop only if he can then try to play e4. Okay, so bishop takes f6.
So not always makes sense to keep two bishops, and in general, knight e1, another way to
He
play,
played knight d2.
to knight d2, but knight e1 a little bit more conventional way to play.
This typical maneuver,
Yeah,
the knight is heading to
to
d5.
put knight on e3, but still I have a decent position in any case with black, I mean.
Yeah, so in this position, maybe first of all, we should put our pieces out of the range of the bishops with rook b8, then bishop d7, knight e7.
Yeah, sure.
Something like this.
Yeah, and the knight e7 just in time to stop knight d5 at tempo, and then d6, and I have a very sound position. Okay, more or less equal evaluation, I believe.
Okay, the game went knight d2.
Yeah, and slowly I was then slowly I was outplaying him. At some point I was better.
Here, let me just ask you something very important. We know that in this structure, b5 is also a very typical idea, just to deflect the c4 pawn, and in this way, we can weaken White's central control. And maybe this was one of your ideas in this game, bishop d7, then you played rook b8 and b5.
So it's quite typical, yes. Sometimes black is playing also. Black is trying to start with a6 and then b5 and take with the pawn. But here, white, I have to put my rook out of this diagonal, as you said exactly. So rook b8 is the must anyway.
And he should start
And.
playing on the king side.
Yeah, he started to play this play, but actually I was happy because without much pieces, it's not so dangerous. So not so dangerous in general, this attack.
Queen g6, e4, and now you are just in time to play b5.
Yeah, I'm just in time, and it looks like actually in this moment. We can conclude that Black's position has to be preferred, I believe.
And in this position, one can feel the absence of White's dark squared bishop, because with the bishop on e3 or c1, the picture would have been completely different.
Yes, with bishop on e3, it would be much more sound for White. But here, f5, it's not. It's actually never dangerous, almost never dangerous, because he is lacking very much proper control over dark squares. So, and in general, there is no way how to continue to attack for white, because g4 and knight f3 and h4, he has just no time to play all these
Yes,
moves. Because I already started my actions
you
here.
just open the B file and try to invade via the B2 square.
Yes, I am already ahead a little bit, I believe, with my play. So, and I have a quite good strategical play here. Strategically, I'm doing very well.
Yeah, so quite a typical idea in this structure. After knight d2, okay, just a second. He played c takes b5, take a4, rook b7. I'm going to fast forward a bit because I want to take a look at one more game.
Sure.
Okay, this, and actually the position is pretty much okay, slightly better for you maybe.
Maybe at some point it was already clearly better. Yeah, and actually it's not so relevant after.
Okay, so if you want, you can show us one of your games with white, just to demonstrate white's great ideas in these positions.
Yeah, sure.
So, which game to select?
What do you prefer? Which one? Maybe d3 or second d3 option, because it makes also a lot of sense.
Okay, c4, e5, and d3.
So d3, yeah, here I played two games. Both games I won. One of them I played against very strong French grandmaster Romain Edouard.
Okay.
So, in general, it was invented in the highest level by Vladimir Kramnik. So, idea is very simple, as usual, to play some sound and less forced position. But here, kind of Nidorf style, not like Dracon style, comparing to G3 lines. Although sometimes, actually, the way I played against Edouard, it was more or less typical English game.
So how he played?
Although he played g6 immediately, I believe.
g6, okay.
It's not the mainstream way to play, actually, because now we are playing something like typical English opening. But only with knight on e7, because he chooses to play knight to 7, which is a bit unconventional way, but also normal.
So
normal pass.
Another option would have been this d6, bishop g2, knight c6.
For instance, e4, maybe you can even play e4, because white has different way of different setups. Also e3, knight g2 makes sense, and of course knight f3,
yes,
the most conventional.
Your friend grandmaster Michael Royce wrote a database about for modern chess about c4 e5. Also he covered c4 c5 and he suggested to play e4 in such positions, this setup with knight e2, h3, castle, then bishop e3, knight d5, rook b1, and start playing on the queen side.
Yeah, actually it was suggested from another author from modern chess by Mikhail Marin, but also many years ago in his great books about English opening.
Yes,
Actually, I learned a lot of ideas from Marin great books, and one of the setups he was covering also e4 setups in this kind of positions.
So he will participate in our camp this weekend. So people will enjoy his style. So
he is real classic of English opening. So it's absolutely make a lot of sense to learn from him.
So knight e7, bishop g2.
And I played e4, in style of Marin and Royce also. And actually h6, as far as I remember, Kramnik played more creative. H4, h6, Kramnik came up with this idea. Yeah. Against Inner Kiev, as far as I remember.
Nowadays, with Alpha 0, they play h4 in every position, right?
Yeah. So it's quite modern way to play. So it's not a big surprise that top grandmaster trying to play almost every, I mean, not in every position, but quite often. H4, one of the top choices of engine nowadays. And this is exactly the case, and he obtained an advantage quite
soon. Yeah, this is the game actually, Kramnik in Arkiev, g takes f4.
So yes, here I think white is clearly better already. So f6, move 8 actually looks quite weird from the first point of view. Looks quite boring and weird, but actually also solid, and black is keeping a solid shape of the position, and maybe it's not that easy to break through for white. So it's still not so clear after f6.
Okay, so e4, c6.
Yeah.
He's trying to prepare d5.
Yeah, I'm not sure this is the good idea here, because I have a quite decent control over d5 square. And also I obtained quite a nice position. I obtained maybe not a big advantage, but at least some initiative.
So now he's ready to play d5, but I liked very much how you responded in quite a typical way, I must say.
Yeah, now I started to play Benoni at some point.
After d5, actually, maybe the Benoni approach is the best one in this structure.
Yeah. So I wanted to switch to Benoni here, because looks tempting, yeah. And bishop c5, yeah. Because normally this bishop, dark squared bishop, again, we were talking before about in my game against Khmelnikin, and also white sometimes having a headache with this bishop. But here I have almost ideal place for bishop on a3. From a3, actually quite safe square from one point of view, and from another point of view, I'm controlling a lot of very important squares. D6 first of all.
Yes, for example, now you attack the e7 knight and put pressure on d5. Therefore, you provoke d4, and we have this typical Benoni position. When if we take Kaur's reversed, his knight will be on c6 and our bishop will be problematic on c1.
Yeah. So quite a big difference.
Yeah, of course. Dream position for a Benoni player.
Dream position, indeed, yeah. So despite it's a dream position, it was not that clear still.
B6, bishop a3.
It was not that clear, and at some point it was not... maybe it was critical position on move 18, as far I remember.
So rook b8, knight d6 was played?
Yeah, because till some point we played well, boss, here. I repeated one time position, and b5 was okay also. And queen e1 here, as far I remember, a5 was interesting.
Uh-huh.
Actually, this is an exchange sacrifice, but it was a proper moment to fight for the initiative, and position was not clear after
if
a5.
If you take then knight c6 with the idea of b4.
Yeah. There is a lot of different tactical ideas. So, of course, it's far from easy to play like a5.
This is the exchange sacrifice.
Yeah, this is an exchange sacrifice, and black has a black from at least from human point of view. I don't remember the engine evaluation, maybe also not that clear, but from point of view of human, black has a very decent compensation, because knight is going to e3 and two bishops also, and so on. So it would be unpleasant if he would play a5, and who knows. Yes. After knight f5, I was happy here, because...
You won the exchange?
But this is a different story. He has no e3... he has no access to a3 square with knight, and then I was better.
This position is already better for you, because besides the exchange, you have a superior control of the white squares.
Yeah, and the most important, I have a lot of open files for my rooks, so I can. I have a lot of.
The king is vulnerable.
I can improve my position more, of course. So, yeah, in general, we can conclude that it's not so easy, even if you have even if you have such a dream position for Benoni players, so you have to be on alert because, yeah, it's still not that clear. Yes, so all these kind of positions are quite double-edged.
So we can say this joke that Benoni is so risky opening that even if you get the dream version, you should be aware.
Yeah, yeah, something like that. And more or less the same if you say the worst bishop is anyway better than knight.
Yes. So I'm quite interested in this concept with d3. Just a second, let me get back to this moment. c4, e5, d3. Since it's a very flexible option, maybe we can expect further developments in the future.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely, absolutely, because it's still quite new. I believe Kramnik started to play just before he got retired. So we lost exceptional player, of course, from point of view of creativity, of strategical understanding and in many other extents. So yeah, in general, Black has different kind of options. Actually, what I suggested here is trying to play with c5 anyway. So if we reverse colors again, this structure with extra central control c5 e5 pawns also makes sense here with Black.
So you prefer c5 with Black here?
No, I mean bishop b4.
Okay,
first.
Bishop b4.
We should set free first.
Yeah,
this
of course.
Bishop,
and now, okay, just let me just flip the board and now c5.
Yeah, it's still a bit unexplored because I think it was invented by Anish Giri again, and it was quite rare. But it makes a lot of sense. So now you have reversed, I don't remember, Moscow variation, as far as I remember the name.
Yes, yeah. Yes, yes.
We have reversed Moscow variation, and it has, it makes a lot of sense again, because now I'm gaining a lot of space in the center, and I have a quite free development. Yeah, and return, I'm ready to giving up this bishop again, but still, it's not such a big price in this kind of position.
So maybe you're going to develop your knight on e7?
No, I believe knight c6 and then d5, my idea in general.
Knight c6 and just follow with d5.
Yeah, d5 and then take with knight probably, but maybe with queen in some position, but in general, just a normal way to play in Moscow variation, but with reversed color.
Yes, in any case, it seems that this variation is quite practical for both colors, because the pawn structure is very flexible. Engines will not help a lot. You can just get a playable position and enjoy playing chess.
Yeah, we can take a look very briefly my another game with Chiki. You see this in annotation. This game, because it was quite instructive,
okay.
Also, the way Black can
just a second. So he played knight f6.
Yeah, yeah.
Knight f3.
Because Black has to be on alert also. It looks harmless from the first sight, but he actually spoiled everything just in a five moves or something.
Queen e7 was played, g3.
Yeah. He also played more or less normal way for the Moscow variation like this, but it was not the case that this is the proper way for Black.
So,
and again, e4 very important.
The same
here.
Structure.
The same structure, the same idea. e4 and d5, it's not a good way to play here because he is not very well prepared. He is quite underdeveloped and his queen is misplaced because after d5, yeah, I have a very nice position and very good. I mean, simply I have an advantage because actually annotation is wrong. I played rook e1, not knight e1, move 11.
So this d5, e takes d5, c takes d5, and you played, okay, rook e1, knight c6, b4, and it's already clear that you have...
It was my game, and white is just better, so black has to be on alert. It's not that easy as it looks. Yeah, it's quite... it's quite tricky line, actually.
And just one final question, if he plays d6, it's somewhat passive and you can just start gaining space on the queen side, right?
Yeah, sure. So it's unclear why he spent so much time with his bishop moves. And then I play d4 at some point, and it should be also pleasant for white. Oh. But still, it was less arrival.
Okay, very interesting. So, I hope that our spectators enjoyed as much as I did, because Pavel showed some really interesting ideas, deep insights of the English opening. Of course, during the training camp this weekend, we are going to examine everything in a great detail, but I hope that this lecture will help you to start better feeling the arising pawn structures. So thank you very much, Pavel, for participating. It was a real pleasure to have you as our guest tonight.
Thank you very much, Grigor, and thanks everyone for watching this, and I hope you will get a lot of pleasure to attend Modern Chess Camp, and then to have a good success with English opening as well after.
Just to remind everyone who participates in the camp will get the PGM version of Pavel's analysis of his games. Just a reminder, our early bird discount of 10 euros expires tomorrow. So those of you who want to register for the camp, now is the best moment. Thank you very much once again, and I hope that we're going to have the opportunity to discuss many other openings as well.
Sure.
Thank you.
Grigor,
all the best. Bye.